Welcome to another Jacket Journey. This week, we're going to follow Kaylee Cummings, a senior paramedic student at City College. Let's check it out.
So, Kaylee, why did you choose the paramedic program?
I've always wanted to work in healthcare, and I did work in the hospital setting for about 2.5 years before considering this program. But the pre-hospital setting has always just kind of seemed like a little bit more, I don't know, adventurous. So I figured I'd do that while I was still able to actually do the work that's required for it. So we're heading to the lab lecture room for the paramedic program. Wednesdays we spend a lot of our time in the lecture, so the classroom section, and Fridays half the class goes in the morning and the other half in the afternoon for the lab settings, where we practice the skills we talk about in the lecture and actually get more experience for when we do our field internships. Okay, so this is the lab. That's quiet. So this is where we have stations where we set up into groups. Each mannequin comes attached with like a sensor, and you get like feedback for vitals, oxygen, just a whole bunch of stuff. We run through scenarios, verbal, we practice skills on the mannequins. They allow us to start IVs, push meds. We practice electrical fixation for cardiac issues, intubation, airway management, and that is all centered out in here.
How long is the program?
So the program is 2 semesters followed by an internship over the summer. The internship can stretch longer, so a lot of the internships, because you are required to work 30 shifts over the summer, and so a lot of the time it stretches over into the beginning of the next program start, but usually it's about a year, year and a half. So the scenario that happened in the back of the ambulance is a trauma scenario. So when you arrive on scene and your patient has obvious signs of trauma, so bleeding, she was intoxicated, she was sitting slumped against a wall, those are all indications that something traumatic has occurred to that patient. So our goal is to stabilize the patient in transport and get them to the emergency room, so that way the very important life-saving procedures that happen at the hospital can happen within a window that allows for the most amount of life-saving. We found a laceration from her face all the way down her neck, and we had arterial bleeding. So we got that, we did manual pressure, so we were trying to stop the bleeding to get her stabilized. As we went through, because we want to make sure we're not missing any wounds, so we get the patient trauma naked, is what it's called. And that's how my classmate found the puncture wound in the abdomen and then on the thigh. And once we got those addressed, so you address any life-threatening conditions on scene. So your airway, so the way you breathe, that is the big thing. So we have to protect the airway, make sure that that's still like intact and going. And then you wanna look at breathing. You wanna make sure the patient is breathing adequately enough to make sure that they're oxygenating properly, which is kind of a really important aspect of living. And then there's the circulation. So we wanted to manage the bleeding, get it as close to under control as we could before we moved the patient. And then we wanted to get them in the ambulance and go. So in the back of the ambulance, what you saw is the treatment for a trauma activation. So the patient was in shock, which means that we couldn't get a blood pressure. We didn't really have a pulse, and they were unresponsive. So the treatment for shock is oxygen, warmth, and fluids. So when you have a trauma patient, you start 2 large bore IVs. The mannequin only had one arm for IVs. That's why you only saw 1 IV present. And you initiate a fluid challenge, so you run fluid into the patient to help maintain their blood pressure at an adequate level. So we want to make sure that blood and oxygen and glucose, everything the brain needs to stay alive, is reaching the brain. And you need to have a set level blood pressure for that to happen. That's about 80 to 90. So we would start 2 IVs, and then her airway failed. So what we did is we took control of the airway by intubating the patient. So once the patient was intubated, we keep getting vitals about every 5 because we want to keep track of the interventions that we did for that patient. The ride that you guys experienced is not the usual. Usually it's a lot calmer. You want to keep your patient as calm as possible. So, you know, driving code, which is lights and sirens, through town, through roundabouts, you know, jerking to stops, going around corners, driving really fast. That's not a very calm environment for the patient, and they're already panicked enough. So unless it is an immediate life threat, like a stroke, and strokes you have like a short window that you need to get to, like a stroke or a CPR, something like a trauma, something that, you know, you experienced, it's a no code response. So it's fairly calm. You follow the, you know, rules of the road. So the speed limits, you stop at all the red lights. When you drive code, you kind of have to bend the rules a little bit. We do lights and sirens because we need that patient at that hospital ASAP, because we're not saving the patient. We are initiating the first step in saving the patient. So we are starting them on the path to recovery, but we're not gonna save their life. We don't have the tools in the back of an ambulance to save someone's life long term. In the short term, we're stabilizing them until we can get them to that treatment. So our usual Fridays are just like the oral scenarios, the mannequin with the little monitor screen, our instructors sitting across the table. We can, you know, verbalize our interventions. But the closer we get to our field internships, the closer we get to actually being in the field and working with like real people and being in these real situations, we start getting more and more lifelike to the situation. Obviously a lot of the stress in this program due to legal issues is manufactured, but we're trying to get it so when we get on the ambulance and we start taking care of people, we don't freeze because we're panicked, because we're scared and we're stressed and we've never been in that situation before. So they're doing everything they can to make sure, our instructors are doing everything that they can to make sure that we are ready and we are safe to be out in that internship.